Okay, so today my plan is to start finally talking about neural networks. This is the part about neural networks. So let me briefly remind you what we did last week. We talked about linear perceptrons, actually this linear hypothesis class that was used in linear regression and in logistic regression and in linear classification. So basically we were considering functions of the form and an inner product. So just a reminder, x is our instance. It's basically the input to the model. It's the data point. We are assuming it is an n dimensional vector in the Euclidean space. And y is, in our simple model, it was just a scalar output. It was basically a hypothesized label. And let's think of a label as a scalar value. It can be something discrete in case of classification or something continuous in case of regression. Okay? And basically, W was, we wrote this W and V in homogeneous coordinates. It was n plus 1 degrees of freedom that distinguished between one hypothesis and another hypothesis. So basically, this is a class of linear hypothesis. And we saw the logistic regression problem, which is, despite the name, is a binary classification problem, right? So it's called regression, but it is classified. Basically, what we did, we actually took this y, which can be any real number that comes out from this affine function, and we plugged it into a function of this form. So basically, we wanted to produce something that looks like probability, something that is non-negative and exists in the range of 0 and 1. So basically, we plugged it into this function, which is called the logistic function, or the sigmoid function. And we, by doing this, we created a model of two probabilities, right? Of two conditional probabilities, the probability y given x, right? So we can write this, essentially, we can think of the output of our model as a vector with two numbers, right? So one number, I don't remember whether we did, yeah, I think we did it this way. This way, right? So this is the probability, we interpret this as the probability of instance X being classified as class 0. And the complementary probability is 1 minus this thing, which is, of course, just 1 over 1 plus this exponent, is the probability of the instance being classified as class 1. Okay, so basically, we can think of y being this. Okay? And obviously, you see, these are non-negative values between 0 and 1, and they sum to 1. So, and we use this in the logistic regression problem. Again, it's a classification. Okay. Now, using this formula, we can easily generalize our linear model to basically to any number of classes, right? Suppose we now want to do classification to k classes. Okay? So what we are going to do, we are going to produce a k-dimensional vector in the output of the linear model, and then pass it through this function, which in this case will be called softmax. Okay? So let's see how we do it. We take y, now there will be a matrix W multiplying x plus a vector of biases b. This is a k-dimensional vector, this is a k-dimensional vector, this is an n-dimensional input vector, and this is a k by n matrix, right? Okay? So the output is a k-dimensional vector. We now plug it into this function. So the function has a numerator that is applied element-wise, and the denominator is applied horizontally. Basically, it sums. So basically, you apply the numerator, you apply the numerator on every output, on every dimension of this output vector, and then you divide by the sum. So basically, as the result, you have something that looks like this. You have e to the power wx plus b, and I remind you that we apply this function element wise. It's a function, it's a scalar function applied to a vector, it's applied element wise, and we divide it by the sum. So in vector notation, this is a vector, right? It's a column vector. To do the sum, I will just compute its inner product with a vector of 1. Okay, so it's a convenient notation that gives me the sum of the elements. Okay? And this is called softmax. Softmax. Why softmax? Because basically what this function does, it emphasizes the highest value in the vector, and it attenuates any value that is significantly lower than the maximum. So it's a kind of maximum with some kind of a blurred maximum. Okay, so this is called softmax. And this is something that is extremely popular in classification problems. Okay, and by the way, I don't think you should be taking pictures because we are putting a YouTube channel with all the videos, so all the materials are there. I mean, of course you can take pictures, but it's redundant. Okay, so that was what we saw last week. And I told you that basically linear models shouldn't be underappreciated. Many problems before trying something more complicated than a linear model, try a linear model. The advantage of a linear model, first of all, it is easy to use, and second, it is quite interpretable. You can actually understand what goes on inside a linear model. And many problems actually work well with linear hypotheses. Of course, it is limited by the very fact of being linear. For example, if I give you classes like this, let's say in R2, I'm giving you 4 points like this. There is no hyperplane that can separate them without errors. Basically, these points are not linear, inseparable. And of course, this is a very simple example. So basically, you cannot implement XOR function using a linear hypothesis. And one of the ways that we have seen last time was actually to do some nonlinear transformation of the data, which can still give, basically, you're still building linear decision boundaries in some future space, but when you translate this back to the original data space, you might come up with very complicated decision boundaries. What we're going to do now, which is basically the workhorse of deep learning, we're going instead to construct a family of nonlinear hypotheses. What we're going to do is the following. We will take this linear perceptron model. It dates back to the 50s, when it was first introduced. And we are going to put some nonlinearity at its output. Essentially, we already put some linearity here, the softmax, but what we are going to do is just this. We will take this matrix W. Here is the bias term that we are adding. Okay? And now I will put some nonlinearity phi. Let's say this nonlinearity will be applied element-wise. It will be applied element-wise. And we'll see some other possibilities as well, like pooling operations, for example, that are not applied exactly element-wise. But let's start with the element-wise operations. So this will create a simple family of nonlinear functions. Okay, this is a nonlinear function. Now let's take this basic building block and just concatenate it by doing function composition. Okay? So let's call this a layer. This will be a layer. Let's call this W1, B1, Phi1. Let's call this a layer. And we'll simply concatenate L such layer. Okay. So now let's use some notation, I will call this y0, which is also x, our input. I will call this output yl, which is also, as a matter of fact, our output. This will be called y1, which is the output of the first layer and the input of the next layer. This is yl minus 1, the output of the second last layer and the input of the last layer. Okay? And let's call this z1, and this z. And of course, we have l minus 2 additional layers in the place of these dots that have the vectors here. Okay? So what we obtain is called a multi-layer perceptron, MLP. Let's put some dimensions here. Suppose, let's say this is an n-dimensional. This is an n-dimensional vector. Let's call it here n 0 equals n. Okay. This is a k-dimensional. It's called nl equals k. I'm thinking of the previous example of classifying two k classes, so creating a vector. I will put some softmax function at the end, obviously, if I'm doing a classifier. And this will be an n1 dimensional vector. So basically, I have each layer has this is n l minus 1 dimensional vector. So basically, I can have different dimensionality of the data between the layers. So the matrices are not necessarily square matrices. Okay. So mathematically, of course, what I did was this. I'm applying phi1. To W1 times something plus B1, right? And this something is W2, phi2. I should be writing it in the other order. Phi out W out plus BL, WL minus 1, L minus 1. Right, like this. And here inside I have W1, phi1, phi1, W1, x plus 1. Okay? Basically, it's just a composition of this function. And this is my output. So you see, you take x, your input, you pass it through this sequence of concatenated functions, and you produce an output 1. Okay? And basically, this is a class of hypotheses. It is parameterized by these weight matrices WIs, and the bias vectors BI. So basically, I will call this some kind of a pseudo vector. It's not exactly a vector, right? The matrices are not of the same size, but let's think of all these parameters, W1 until WL and B1 until BL. Let's think of these as the parameters of my hypotheses. Okay? So basically, by changing these parameters, I will create different functions. And of course, you can always parse this pseudo vector into a long vector that takes all these parameters. And unlike the linear perceptron that was limited to the types of functions it can represent, actually there are theorems showing that multi-layer perceptrons, even with two layers, L equals 2, are universal approximators. So under some mild technical conditions, if you put sufficient number of degrees of freedom, you can represent any function. Okay, so it's by just putting this non-linearity and adding one more layer actually gives incredibly more powerful representation capacity. Okay? Yes?
So, in some way, you consulting with like L hypothesis, and is it a certain way to do some I don't know, some sort of voting. Like there's a hypothesis that got an input and then propagated to another hypothesis that.
Well,
how different it is with the ensemble? How different it is from ensemble voting when you have few hypotheses and you take some averaging?
Okay. So first of all, let's say at a very coarse level, the difference is between collecting things in parallel or in a series, right? So here, the different layers, if you think of them as individual hypotheses, they are processing the output of the previous hypothesis, right? So everything, all these sequence of operations constitutes a single hypothesis. So this is the map from input to output. You might find useful some intermediate outputs, but usually they are not so not so important. What is important is what comes out at the end. If you are talking about some kind of ensemble of hypotheses, then you are connecting them in parallel, right? The same input goes to all of them, they produce different outputs, and then you somehow combine. Okay, so it's completely different, completely different way. Okay, so basically, so this is a multi-layer reciprocal, or in the jargon of deep learning, this is called the fully connected layer. We'll see basically what is the alternative to a fully connected layer, what can be exactly not fully connected. Okay, so basically this is a multi-layer reciprocal, and one thing that we can another way to view this architecture. So another way to view this architecture actually is by thinking it in terms of graph theory, basically some kind of a flow graph. So let's take one of these layers. Suppose these are the inputs to the ice layer number I. So its input, we call it this is Y. This is yi minus 1, okay? So this is yi minus 1, 1, yi minus 1, 2. Let's say this is yi minus 1, j, and this is yi minus 1, n I minus 1, okay? Which is the dimension of the input vector. So this is the input vector. Now, this will be the output vector, yi, right? This is yi 1. Yi2, let's say yik. I'm writing the individual coordinates, and this is yin. Okay, I apologize for the these many indices, but unfortunately, this is probably the simplest notation I can think of. Okay, what we are doing here, basically, what the layer does, it takes. So, first of all, this thing is connected to a nonlinear. Let's examine, for example, what happens. Here, right? So the reason nonlinearity here, it's the same element-wise nonlinearity that we call phi I. It's the same nonlinearity here and here. Okay, it's the same phi I. Now this nonlinearity is connected to a sum. Here goes b I k. Right, b is a vector, right, and this is the kth dimension of the vector bi, and here go all the inputs weighted by some weight, okay, and this weight will be wi minus one, sorry, wi jk, sorry, kj, if we think of it as the matrix, kj. Okay, so k will be, so the output dimension is the first index of the matrix. I'm writing the subscript as a superscript to indicate the layer number, and basically the two subscripts here, k and j, are the first and the second dimension of the matrix. Okay, so it's the kjth element of the matrix wi. Okay, so basically you have a weighted sum plus the bias, pass it through the linearity, and you get the output here. And of course, basically you have ni such sums, right? So basically you have some kind of an acyclic weighted directed graph, right? with no, exactly means that there are no loops, no feedback. So this is called a feed-forward neural network. And this single unit that I wrote here is called a neuron. In this jargon, it's called a neuron. Just because it at least people believed in the 50s that this is how the biological neurons work, and we have many evidences that this is not how the biological systems work. First of all, because there is a lot of feedback in biological systems, there are no continuous values in biological systems, we use what is called action potentials that can be thought of as a train of spikes, train of impulses. But anyway, still there is some at least structural resemblance to a neuron that has dendrites that connect to other neurons and an axon that forwards that basically forwards this out to some other neuron. Anyway, so this is basically the concatenation of such neurons. Basically, a layer has a collection of neurons. We concatenate them into a acyclic graph, and we call the entire collection of such neurons a neural network. Okay? Or, if you want to be precise, it's an artificial neural network as opposed to a biological neural network.
This is a simple sum?
This is a simple sum, weighted sum, yes. Okay, so the weights are, of course, the WIs that we have on the graph page. Okay? Yes?
Does the indexing should go for K and not for N?
Okay, so K, so first of all, the superscript I means that we are in the ith layer, right? Now, the first dimension, WKJ, right? So it takes the input J, so it's the column number, J is the column number, and K is the row number corresponding to that one. I think it's correct.
Oh, right.
Yes.
But in general, don't you miss like another dimension of the input vector itself?
No. So the first layer will be facing the input. And this is what is called a hidden layer. It's an intermediate layer. Of course, if you put I equals 1 here, it will be operating on the...
No, I mean like the size of the vector itself. If it's some, say, state vector or something, it has like elements, right?
Okay, sure. So the input dimension is dictated by the size of the data that you feed to the network. The output of the network is also dictated, for example, by the number of classes that you would like to produce. And the intermediate sizes can be chosen arbitrarily.
So it's another dimension.
Yeah, so I'm not making any assumption, this is just J and I minus 1. And of course, at the two ends, it has to match some predetermined number. Okay? But in between, it has freedom. So basically, the parameters that we are going actually to learn, we are going to search over, are these W's and the B's. The sizes of the matrices, the number of layers, and the types of the nonlinearities are fixed. At least this is how most of the neural network approaches work. You can do some kind of what is called the architectural search. You can also do some kind of combinatorial search over these parameters as well. This is a more sophisticated set of techniques, which are a cutting-edge research right now. Okay, so basically we are assuming that we just have those parameters. Still, it is a very rich terminal function. Okay. Now, regarding nonlinearity, now by trying to mimic biological systems, a very typical choice from the more or less 60s, maybe even before, was some kind of a saturated function, either a current saturated function or something that is called sigmoid, basically something that looks like our logistic function, something like this. So this is a sigmoid function; it takes the input and saturates it between 0 and 1. Okay, so for example, this is 1 over 1 plus e to the minus t. Okay, this is phi of t. Let's have it. And you can take, for example, if you take the hyperbolic tangent, which is the hyperbolic sine minus over the hyperbolic cosine, you can get a function like this, but it now ranges between minus 1 and 1. Okay, this is between 0 and 1. It's basically, just think of it as a scale and shifted version of the sigmoid function. And you can take the inverse tangent basically, sorry, the inverse cosine function, the arc cosine function as well, give similar effect. The problem here, and we will come to it when we talk about the gradients of this network with respect to its parameters, is that pay attention how the derivative looks like. So the derivative here is zero on both ends, which is plus or minus infinity. Then it goes to some maximum value and basically decays around the zero, right? And depending on how you scale exactly this thing, it might have some high derivative at zero or maybe something less than one. When you, we will see that basically the chain rule will tell us to multiply these derivatives many times if you want, for example, to see how the parameters of the first layer influence the output. Okay? And if you take something that is bigger than one and you multiply it, let's say, 20 times, you will get something very big, right? And if you take something that is smaller than one and multiply it 20 times, you will get something very small. So this numerically means that it will be very difficult to train something of sufficient depth. Okay? And this is one of the reasons why in modern neural networks, we don't really find such nonlinearities, maybe except at the last layer. What we find instead is something that looks like this. So this is called a ReLU, or a rectifier. It is a rectified linear unit, just some weird abbreviation. Basically, what this function does is sometimes it is denoted as these square brackets with plus. So basically, it means saturate at zero. This is the maximum between t and zero. Okay? So basically, you are an identity function for positive numbers, and you are zero for a negative number. Okay?
Why don't you skip the nonlinearity?
Pardon?
Why don't you skip the nonlinearity?
If you skip the nonlinearity, you can just multiply all the matrices and get a linear precedence. Right? Which we know is of insufficient representation capacity.
Even if we have a convolution, no one.
Same story. Convolution is a linear operation. Okay, so you must have a nonlinear. And this is what makes the analysis of such networks very complicated. Okay? So you must have a nonlinearity. So here the gradient will be zero, here, one here. If you concatenate many such things, you have again a gradient of either zero or one. Okay? So basically you don't have this problem of vanishing or exploding derivatives. And you have a non-differential point zero, which is not exactly a problem if you use appropriate tools for doing optimization. Okay? A question? Yes.
We actually critically rely on those derivatives. I mean, shouldn't we preserve the real derivative? I mean, it's essential for us to make some gradient descent.
Okay. So first of all, so let's get to gradient descent in a few minutes. So basically, currently I'm just telling you how this hypothesis looks like, right? But now we need to search over all the hypothesis plus and find the best hypothesis. Okay. So let's remind ourselves what was our supervised learning problem. Can I take this up? Okay, let's do this. So let's just remind ourselves what was the setting of a supervised learning problem. Of course, we will talk about other training regimes as well. But let's start with supervised learning, which is the easiest setting. Okay, so remember that the purpose of learning was to generalize to some latent distribution or joint distribution in our data cross-label space, basically instance cross-label, from a finite sample of labeled instance, right? So basically we have some finite sample of this form, xi and yi, right? I going from 1 to capital N, this is our training sample, training set. We set some loss function, which I told you that we usually combine as the empirical average of some pointwise losses. So we have our pointwise loss at sample x, which is the hypothesis parameterized by parameters theta at xi, which produces a hypothesized label yi hat, right? This is the label that we believe, according to the hypothesis h theta, that the instance belongs to. And this is the true label, so we have some divergence, some loss function that measures the divergence between the two. And then we take the empirical average of this in our training sample, and let's call this L theta. Okay, this is our in-sample loss or empirical loss that we would like to minimize. Minimize over theta, of course. Theta captures the variability of different hypotheses that we can search for, right? So let's just, for convenience, let's just forget about this yi. Let's embody it just by using slightly different notation. Let me call this L theta equals to 1 over n, I from 1 to n. Let's call this Li h theta x. Okay, so basically this Li, I'm thinking of these pointwise losses as a different function. Because anyway, we are interested in how this function behaves as a function of theta. And now we would like to minimize it over theta. Okay? And for the sake of this discussion, I'm assuming that I'm simply parsing all these pseudo-vector with all the parameters of the network into one long vector. And basically, this is a vector value function. Okay? Now, basically, what we need to do, we need to understand what exactly we are going to find. So when I write this minimization problem, I'm actually interested in a global minimizer of this function, right? So I'm interested in some theta star, which is a global minimizer. What is a global minimizer? A global minimizer is a point such that the function doesn't take any value inferior to the value of the function at that point, right? Basically, it means that for every other theta in some domain in which it is defined, L theta is non-inferior than L theta star. Okay? There might be more than one global minimizer, but certainly there is no point with a value smaller than the one at theta star, right? And so we call the argument, the arg mean, the minimizer, and the value of the function at that point, the minimum. Okay, and sometimes, which is slightly a bit of notation, we will call both minimum. Okay, but basically the argument itself is called the minimum. Unless we assume some special properties about our function L, this problem is impossible to solve. It's impossible to find the global minimizer of a function. It's simply an unsolvable problem. Unless you have some properties like convexity, for example. Convexity makes every local minimizer also a global minimizer. But basically, what we can really hope to find, and actually this is a much simpler problem, it's a solvable problem, we can find a local minimizer. So what is a local minimizer? Pardon? Exactly, so basically it's a global minimizer in some vicinity of it. So basically if a point is a global minimizer in some ball around it, then we will call it a local minimizer. So let's just define if theta star is a local minimizer if there exists some epsilon such that theta star is a global minimizer on this ball of radius epsilon centered at theta star, and you select ball in which center. It must be open neighborhood of theta star. Okay? So finding a local minimizer is a much easier task. Why? Because we can characterize local minimizers by using local information, which is a fancy way of saying derivatives. So we can if we study the derivative of of our function, we can, first of all, we can tell whether we are at a minimum or minimizer or not, right? Mm-hmm. So remember from elementary multivariate calculus. So we have this necessary condition, first order necessary condition for optimality. So if we are assuming that L is C1, which means that it has a continuous derivative, or at least up to first order, then at the minimizer, the gradient of L will bend. Okay? Now, obviously, this is... So first of all, if we select that ReLU nonlinearity, then our function is not C1. Okay? So don't really, at least as of now, we don't really know what to do with this. But let's ignore this for a second. Let's assume that we have some smooth nonlinearity. Then, of course, it's a necessary condition. It's not a sufficient condition. There might be other points with essentially with negative curvature, like maxima or saddle points, that also satisfy this condition. So this is actually a condition for what is called an extremal point. It can be a minimum, maximum, or a saddle. We need second order information, basically second order derivatives, the Hessian matrix, to actually be able to distinguish between minima and other non-minimal extremal points. Unfortunately, in practical applications of deep learning, where we have millions of parameters, computing a million by million Hessian matrix is simply impractical. So we will never use any second order information. What we can do instead, we can just ignore this fact that we don't know whether we are at a minimum or not. Because what we are going to do anyway, we are going to use stochastic optimization. We are going to use something that is noisy by design. And the fact that anything that has negative curvature is unstable means that we will never be stuck at a point that is not a minimum. Okay? So basically, just this reason already allows us not to check the second order information to actually understand whether we are stuck in some non-minimal extremal point, because there will be no such case. Okay? This is also one of the reasons why to use stochastic optimization. Of course, there will be many more fundamental reasons why. Okay? So basically, if this is our optimality condition, we can actually construct a very simple algorithm that starts at some point and leads us to an extremal point like this. So basically, we can write it as sort of an algorithm. We start with some initial theta 0, and then for k, 1, 2, until some convergence, until some stopping criterion is satisfied, we're going to do the following. We are going to select a descent direction. Let's call it dk. Second, we would like to select a direction in making it at least a small step in which we'll decrease the value of the function.
What do you mean by direction?
Pardon?
What do you mean by the direction?
Direction is a vector in the space of your parameter theta. So if theta is a million dimensional vector, then the direction will be a million dimensional vector in this space. So direction means that you are making a step. So currently you are, let me write it here. Currently you are at the point theta k, you're producing, or let's say you're producing the current iterate theta k as theta k minus 1 plus some step size in the direction k. Okay? This is what I mean by direction. It doesn't necessarily need to be a unit vector. Okay, and here we select step size. Okay? So basically this is actually this is the family of algorithms, obviously, which are called descent algorithms. And practically practically half of all optimization algorithms, unconstrained optimization algorithms that you will find, are one or another sort of descent algorithm. There is another family called trust region methods that basically gets do sort of the logical dual of this. But basically, the most important ingredient here is how to select the descent direction, and of course, the second important ingredient is how to select the step size. Okay? Yes?
Can I ask some fundamental question? Last lecture, we talked about those YIs in those tuples. And we talked that they come from the target function. The target function.
Or target is hidden, they might be noise.
Yeah, exactly. But we never really know it, right? I mean, practically. We are not sure that we really know it. I mean,
well, depends on the settings. So there are settings where you don't have any labeled training set, and then you are talking about some other training regimes like unsupervised training, for example. But if, for example, you can put a human, some piece of human intelligence to label some representative set of data, then you have the labels, right? So it might be that the labels are available, but they are simply costly to obtain. Then you might have some labeled data set and another zillion of data points without labels. Then you're in a regime that is kind of hybrid between supervised and unsupervised, and it's called semi-supervised.
Okay, I see. So what is the essential reason that we, I don't know if you actually ignored, but you did this step that we only thought about the hypothesis of function distribution, and you put aside the y, or maybe you...
No, it's just a notation, right? It's just a notation. So basically, this li is actually the function. So basically, yi is not our argument anymore, right? Our argument is theta. So basically, I'm thinking of each L with the second parameter yi as a new function li. Okay, just for the notational convenience. Uh-huh. I'm not doing anything new. It's exactly the same.
Because it's always the same thing, so we sort of hide it.
So basically it's a sum of different functions, because every y gives you a different function of theta, right?
Yeah.
Okay?
But it's always there in our mind.
Of course. Okay. The y's are always there. Let's talk about the descent direction first. So, so basically, what we would like to examine, the function of this form. So suppose, let me drop those iteration numbers. So suppose I'm currently standing at point theta, somewhere in the parameter space of my capital thesis, and I'm looking for, basically I would like to make a step in some direction d, and the step of size eta, let me drop eta. Let's embody the step size directly into d. Okay. So basically, I would like to make some increment to my parameters, and let me put eta. Okay. So basically, once I selected d, my only degree is the degree of freedom remaining is some scale, some step size, which is a one-dimensional parameter. By which amount I'm going to step in the direction b. Okay? So let me think of this as a new function of eta. Okay? It's a one-dimensional function. And I can actually ask whether this function decreases when I make a small positive step in the direction b, right? So I can verify this by taking the derivative of f at point zero, right? Which is simply the derivative of L theta plus eta d over d eta at equals zero. Okay? And we know from elementary calculus that this will be just the inner product of the gradient at point theta with the direction d. Okay? So one way to see this is called the directional derivative of the function L at point theta in direction d. Okay, this is called the direction of the and one way of seeing this relation is by remembering that basically when we change the argument of our function, when we change the argument by some d theta, right? The function changes by some value delta theta, right? And this linear approximation changes by a quantity that we call d l, which is called the differential of the function, right? And if in the limit when d theta becomes very small, if this the linear change, the change of the linear approximation equals to the change of the actual function, we say that the function is differentiable and dl over d theta is called the dl. Okay? So basically in the multivariate case, the relation between the differential and the change of the argument is given by an inner product with an object, which is a vector, because d theta is a vector of the same dimension as theta, and this object is called the gradient. Okay? The gradient at point theta. Okay? A gradient is an operator from Rn to Rn, but when you evaluate it at a point, it is basically the object that, under the inner product, gives you the differential. Okay? And then from this relation, you can immediately see this. Okay? So this is our direction of derivative. We want our direction of derivative to be negative, right? In order to have a decrease in the value of the function, we would like the direction of derivative to be negative. So basically, let me draw the level lines of our function. These are the level lines. When we move tangentially to the level line, what is the direction of the derivative?
It's a perpendicular.
Tangential. We are on the level line. We make an infinitesimal step in
so,
the
so
tangent.
So the direction of the derivative?
No. This is my level line, and I'm stepping a small step in the direction of the level line.
Yeah. Right.
So zero change, right? Because
yes.
I'm on the level. So this direction is the direction of the level line, the tangential direction. The gradient
is
perpendicular to this direction. Let's call this number L. And this point theta. Of course, it's evaluated at this point theta. Okay, and it points us to the direction in which the function increases its length. Okay? And if we want to make if we would like to draw a direction that increases the value of the function, it must produce a negative inner product with the gradient, right? The negative inner product means that it forms an obtuse angle with the gradient, right? So this d, in order to be a descent direction, needs to form an obtuse angle with the gradient. Okay? This is the characterization of a descent direction. This is the geodetic interpretation. Okay? Now, let's ask ourselves, and then let's do this reasoning for 2 minutes, and then we'll do the break. Let's ask ourselves, among all possible directions, which one will bring us, which one will give us the biggest decrease in the value of the function, the steepest decrease? So let me formulate the question. Okay, so let's be slightly more rigorous, because the answer will be, well, not surprising, but the answer will be depends.
Yes.
Okay? Let's see, depends on what. So let's take our function and approximate it linearly around some point theta. So basically I'm doing a Taylor series expansion, first order. So my L, theta plus d, approximately equals L theta plus the inner product of the gradient at point theta with d. And the change in the value of the function is this, right? It's a linear, it's approximately, it's a linear function of d. Okay? And I would like to minimize this. I want this to be as negative as possible. Okay? So let's minimize this. We are minimizing this linear approximation, right? Which d gives this minimum?
Opposite to the gradient.
You're trying to recite some formula that you remember, that you know, but let's think of it. So give me d that minimizes this linear function.
And they are parallel. And
so theta stays the same, so we just want to...
Yeah, it's a constant.
Great. So we just to be as close to L theta, but just a little bit smaller than this.
Why? So let's draw the level lines. So these are my level lines. These are basically level lines formed by a plane with a normal in the direction of L phi, right? Mm-hmm. This is how a linear, the level lines of a linear
function. It's a constraint minimization problem.
Pardon?
It's a constraint minimization problem.
There is no constraint here, yet.
But you must, in order for the problem to have some name, you must know that the magnitude of these...
Exactly. So this is an unbounded minimization problem, right? So you give me some d that forms a descent direction, I will multiply it by 1 billion, and I will get a smaller number, right? So small, and then of course a negative number, but a smaller one. So basically it means that this problem is unbounded, so it doesn't make any sense to ask this question. What we need is to either divide by some norm of D, or simply constrain, put a constraint, basically to constrain D to be of unique norm. So basically we are putting a unique ball here, and we are asking which of the vectors on this unique ball will minimize this function, okay? And then, of course, the answer depends on which norm we select, okay? If we, for example, select the L2 norm, obviously we will get the negative gradient, or the normalized negative gradient. If we select, for example, the L1 norm, we'll get the coordinate with the highest absolute value of the gradient, which leads to what is called a coordinate descent, okay? We can use different norms and get some other descent directions that still have a meaning and might have a use. But basically, we will be satisfied with the L2, so we will get D equals minus the gradient at point theta, which will produce a family of operators that are known as gradient descent. So any solution to this problem is called a steepest descent direction, but steepest in the sense of some norm, and in the case of the L2 norm, we call it a gradient descent. Okay? So let's say we answered point one. Okay? Now I don't want to tell too much things about point two. So let's say a few words about how to select the step size after the break, and then when we talk about stochastic gradients next week, we'll say a few more words about the selection of the step size. Okay? So I didn't actually tell you how to stop this process, basically how we know that we have a good result, or at least that continuing to minimize this loss function will actually lead to a worse result. So we'll talk about it next week. Basically, what you actually do, you take part of your training set and you put it aside and call it a validation set. So basically, you're trying to see the generalization error on the validation set, and as long as it decreases, basically your, or at least has some tendency of decrease, it means that you are generalizing well, that you are improving. When it starts increasing, it means that you start to overfit, that you start to memorize your training set instead of doing good generalization. And basically this is how these processes are stopped. It's quite useless to check optimality conditions. Also because we are using stochastic optimization. Now, we already agreed that we are going to do negative gradient steps, basically L2 optimal steepest descent, gradient descent. Now, regarding the step size, so one of the natural choices that is extremely frequent in optimization is basically once we have the descent direction, we can again look at this one-dimensional single variable function f eta and find its minimum, or at least guarantee sufficient decrease by looking for r minimum or some approximate r minimum of l theta plus eta b. Okay, so we are looking for some eta k, eta k that will minimize this. Okay. And this is called line search. Actually, finding this minimum over a line, over a one-dimensional parameter space, is very easy. It's easy, but if you have a few millions or tens of millions of parameters, every call to such line search that you should probably do on the full batch of your training data, which might also include millions of data points, it's actually extremely expensive, unaffordably expensive. Not only in terms of the amount of computational complexity, but also in terms of that this will simply not fit into your memory. This is why stochastic optimization is preferred in the first place, because you cannot really fit all the training set into, for example, your GPU memory, which, of course, is a much bigger bottleneck than just the computational complexity. So line search is not used in this kind of optimization problem. What is typically done, we start with some fixed step size, mm-hmm. and we are doing fixed step gradient descent iterations, which is a horrible thing to do, but it's more or less the only thing that we can do. And then we gradually decrease the step size, make it decrease to zero. There are some other nuances that we will see once, like momentum when we talk about stochastic gradient descent. But if you like the statistical mechanical point of view, thinking of gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent as some random walk, basically the step size will somehow correspond to the temperature of your system. And basically decreasing the step size is like decreasing the temperature, and that's why it's called annealing, like annealing of a metal or some other material in statistical mechanics. So basically you decrease the step size, and this is what most frequently is done in the cloud. But again, there are other nuances that we will see in the future. Okay? So once we established our at least general optimization framework, remember that we are doing negative gradient steps with some decreasing step sizes. Now let's go to the main point. How do we compute the gradient? So remember, we need the gradient of the loss function, which is not written here anymore, but we need a gradient of some L theta with respect to the parameters of the network, right? With respect to all the WIs and the BIs, okay? So let's start with a simple illustration with a neural network with just two layers. Let's call this layer, we have a layer A. So the second layer, the last layer, will be A, nonlinearity phi. This is the output of the network. And here we have some other nonlinearity. I will also call it phi, but with a different script. Maybe it's a horrible notation. You replace it by something you like more. And here we have a matrix B. I will write this afterwards carefully with all the indices of all the layers in an L layer network, but I don't want to show you the principle with all these indices. It will just obscure the idea. Okay? So we have this input here. Let's call this intermediate output Z. So basically this is what goes into the activation function, to the nonlinearity of the neuron. Let's call this Z prime, and let's call this Y prime. Okay, so Y prime is the input to the is the intermediate output of the first layer and the input to the second layer. Okay? So mathematically, of course, we can write, so I ignored here the bias terms. I will add the bias terms afterwards. But basically, let's find the derivatives with respect to the matrices A and B. The biases will be handled in the same way. So basically, I can write that Y is phi of A of Z, right? Which is phi of A of different phi bs. Okay? So this is my network.
A and B are our matrices.
These are our parameters. Okay? So remember that this theta was some kind of an artificial creature. Actually, we are interested in blocks of coordinates in this vector, which correspond to matrix A, to matrix B. They're computed differently. So basically, what I will show you is how to compute these blocks of parameters in the gradient network. Okay. So basically, once I have the gradient with respect to B, I can make a step to update the parameters B. Once I have the gradient with respect to A, I can make a step, a gradient descent step, to update the parameters of A. Right? So I can compute these portions of the gradient separately. Okay, so basically what we are interested in is some loss function of y, okay? And we want this gradient with respect to A and B. Let's compute the gradient with respect to A. Okay? So basically we have a composition of functions. What is the rule that we know from calculus that tells us how to compute derivatives of composition of functions? The chain, right? So it's known since Leibniz form, since Newton. So basically we would like to compute the gradient of L with respect to the parameter theta. So first of all, let's talk about the size, the dimensions of this object. So L is a scalar, right? It produces a number, right? Now what is A? A is a matrix with some size, right? I'm not writing the dimensions here. We can put dimensions. What will be the size of this gradient? Size of A, right? The gradient is always size of A. Yes?
No?
Okay, yes, question?
In the first equation, it should be A y prime, not A z, right?
A y prime, thanks, of course, A y. Thanks. Yeah, z is always, it says phi z, right? Z is already A y prime. So basically, let's write the chain rule. So let's write the chain rule. That will allow me some kind of sloppy notation. Chain rule, we can write it from right to left. So first I will have the derivative of L with respect to y, which is a vector, right? Then I have the derivative, which is called a Jacobian, because y is a vector, right? Y is a vector with respect to some matrix. Then I will have basically this Jacobian of y with respect to A. Right? Now, y is a vector, A is a matrix, this object is a tensor of order 3, right? So it's a matrix with 3 dimensions, right? There is a coordinate, so if you write it in coordinate, there will be some coordinate of y and 2 coordinates of A, right? 2 indices of A and y index of y, right? So it's basically dyk over daij, right? 3 indices means third order tensor, which is ugly and not nice. Of course, we can compute it, but actually, pay attention that we never basically. Well, what I mean here by this product, it's a tensor product, right? It's a product of a tensor with a vector. Essentially, I'm summing over k here. Okay, so I'm summing. So I could have used Einstein's convention, but it's just cumbersome to explain. Basically, I'm summing over this k. Okay? And as a result, so I'm multiplying a tensor with a vector, I'm reducing one of the dimensions, right? And I'm getting a matrix of size of A. Right? I'm eliminating K, I'm left with I and J. Okay? Is it clear? So this is my chain. Now, pay attention that I never actually need this third order tensor. I only need to multiply by a vector from the right, right? So let's take advantage of this fact. Let's take advantage of the fact that we have some layered structure in order to find a more elegant way to compute this gradient. Of course, I can just apply the chain rule. It will be tedious calculation, but eventually I will get my gradients correct. But let's take advantage of this layered structure. So I will introduce a notation that is very common in deep learning literature. I will denote the gradient of the loss with respect to some parameter, let's say parameter A. I will denote it as delta A. So basically, in general, so if I want the derivative of L with respect to some parameter star is a placeholder for any letter, I will call it delta star. Okay, so delta is delta A, delta B is the derivative of L with respect to A and B. Of course, through the chain rule. Okay? So in this notation, and you will see that this will simplify notation a lot. So in this notation, the gradient of A, the gradient of L with respect to A, is the sum over K. I'm not writing the upper index of the sum, right? I mean, it can be any dimension. We are responsible people. We know this, that we must combine dimensions in appropriate ways so that the products are defined. So basically, I have this Jacobian, or basically one of the think of this as a three-dimensional matrix. One of the two-dimensional slices of this Jacobian, the kth slice, times delta yk. And delta yk is nothing but the kth element of the gradient of the loss with respect to its input, right? So basically, delta y is single. Delta y is simply the gradient of the loss at my current point one. Okay? That's it. Okay, it's a vector value, it's a scalar value function of a vector variable. Take the gradient, this is delta y. Okay? Now, let's see what is this slice of the Jacobian. Okay, so I'm looking for the derivative of yk with respect to a, right? And y is phi a y prime, right? And basically, when I'm looking for the kth coordinate, it will correspond to the kth row of a, right? So only the kth row of a will be participating. The rest is independent. I mean, the rest of the elements of a do not affect yk. Right? So basically, this Jacobian, of course, is the size of A, but it will be a matrix with just the kth row filled with something. The rest will be zero. Okay? What is this something? So let's draw it like this. There will be the kth row will be filled with some numbers and zeros here, right? So how will it look like? What will be the content of this kth row? So first of all, there will be basically the outer derivative. There will be the phi dot, right? Phi prime. It will be phi prime at, let's call this zk. Okay, this is phi prime of zk, right?
Which is actually y prime.
It's the argument of phi, right? Zk. Oh. Mm-hmm. It's the kth row of a times y.
Yeah, but the result of phi prime on zk
is a number.
Means y prime. No? It doesn't produce the y prime? No,
so I'm talking about the last layer for now. Derivative with respect to A, not to B. B, we will see what happens with B. Okay? So first of all, we have this outer derivative. Now the inner derivative with respect to A. What is the inner derivative with respect to A? It is y prime transpose, right? And it actually makes sense because it exactly has the dimensions of the row dimension of the matrix A. Okay? So basically this is the Jacobian, the rest is zeros. When we compute this sum, with the delta y case, we are actually filling the matrix. We are summing these matrices scaled by delta y k, right? So the result here will be a matrix filled with phi prime z one delta y one. Y prime transpose until phi y prime z sum, let's call it n sum, as I mentioned, delta y n y prime transpose. Okay? Which I can write more compactly as a diagonal matrix, diag f prime z. F prime z is a vector of the size of z, and I'm putting it into a diagonal matrix. To scale the rows of this times the diagonal matrix containing delta y's. Okay, same story here. times, basically, I need to scale this basically matrix with the rows identical to y prime. So let me write this as an outer product 1 y prime. Okay. So this outer product will just create a matrix filled with y prime. Okay. So this is my gradient with respect to A. Okay. Now let's see what happens in the deeper layer, in the first layer. So I want the gradient with respect to B. Okay, so basically, in the next layer, we have, so let's write it like this. I want the gradient of L with respect to B. Let's write it as dL over dB, right? Which is, again, I am applying the chain rule. I would like to take the derivative of the loss with respect to y prime. So I'm just replicating what we did before. So instead of y, I will take y prime. So it's, before I had the output of the first of the last layer, now I have the output of the first layer, which is called y prime. And here it will be dy prime over dB. Okay, so dy prime over dB, presumably I will compute it the same way I computed dy over dA, right? I will just substitute, instead of z it will be z prime, instead of dy it will be dy prime, instead of y prime it will be x, and so on, right? Same story, and instead of phi, it will be phi different script, different nonlinear. Now, what is this dL over dy prime? So basically, I can write this again, chain rule. So dL over dy prime is dL over dy, dy over dy prime, and dy prime over dB. Okay, this is simple. Chain rule, just remember that we are multiplying tensors and we are always multiplying by the last dimension. Okay? Now, this one was, we call this delta 1, right? Now, we need to compute this Jacobian of dy with respect to dy prime, right? Now, this one, we already know how to compute, right? So let's first write this term. So dy prime over dB will look like that matrix. Let me first compute this Jacobian, and then we basically then we'll just replicate that result. Okay. So let's compute this Jacobian. Okay. So basically, this Jacobian, what we have is this: we have y prime. We have y, phi, some matrix A, and y prime, right? So basically y equals phi A y prime, okay? Now what will be the Jacobian? This Jacobian is a matrix, right? It's the derivative of a vector with respect to a vector. So it will be a vector. What should be the dimensions of this? So it should be a matrix. What are the dimensions of this matrix?
Multiplication of the
dimension. So what is the first dimension?
Of A? Or
A?
I didn't...
So what's it, what is the dimension of this object? Dy over dy prime?
It's just k.
Well, so A, let's say the dimensions of A, let's call them...
Dimensions of A is k on
Let's call them m by n.
Ah, it's n by n.
M by n.
M by n, so m by m. The dy prime.
Well, so just as some kind of general rule, when you take derivatives, matrices are transposed. Okay, so it will be the size of A transposed. Okay, you can check it by doing coordinates, right? Basically, what is the dimension of A transpose? So dimension of A is the dimension of Y, right?
Again?
The first dimension of A is the dimension of Y. The second dimension, the column dimension of A, is the dimension of Y prime, right? Because it multiplies Y prime from the right.
Yeah, that's right.
So basically, when you write the Jacobian dy over dy prime, you write it first the dimension of y prime, and then the dimension of y. Because the numerator, you're always summing over the last dimension of the tensor. You want this to be the last dimension, okay? When you multiply it in this order, right? Basically, you want this to be the last dimension, therefore it has the dimensionality of A transpose. So let me write A transpose, which is what comes out of the inner derivative, right? It must be A transpose. What comes from the outer derivative is the diagonal matrix of phi prime, right? It's the diagonal matrix of phi prime, scaling the rows of this thing, right? So it's the diagonal matrix of phi prime at point, we call it Z, right? Times A transpose. Okay? So this is this Jacobian. And once you multiply by, so we know this Jacobian, if we multiply delta y by this Jacobian, what we get here, we can call it delta y prime. Do you agree? So we multiply by this thing, our delta y, and we get delta y prime. Okay? Because what is delta y prime? It's the derivative of L with respect to y prime. This thing. Okay? Now basically we are exactly in the same situation that we were before. Instead of y we have y prime, instead of delta y we have delta y prime, we forgot about how we got there, right? We now have the derivative of the loss with respect to y prime, and we need to compute that sum, right? We need to compute essentially this. So we need to compute the gradient of L with respect to B, right? Which we can call in our notation delta B, right? And then it was delta A. So
can you just
take the marker? Sure. So this is delta B, and it will be the sum over K delta Y prime. So basically, B for y, k, y prime k over b times delta y prime k. Okay, so it's exactly what we had there with respect to different matrix and basically one layer into the network. Okay, so basically now we are treating this intermediate output of the first layer as if it were the output of the network. We just propagated the gradient of the loss one step back. Okay? So basically what we will do again, I will just write the final result. It will be the diagonal matrix of the nonlinearity of the first layer prime. At point, instead of z, we call it z prime. Diagonal matrix of delta y prime times 1, and the input is x. Okay? Now, can you see a recurrent relation?
Just multiply by another diagonal matrix, which we might be able to calculate.
Okay. So first of all, so let me show you the operations that we need. I will separate them into two parts. Okay. Let me write them here. So first of all, I computed. I'm taking the data point x and I'm computing z prime equals bx. Then I'm computing y prime equals phi z prime. Then I'm computing z equals a y prime. Then I'm computing y equals different phi z. Right? So I'm propagating my data forward through the network until I get the output. Okay? This was basically one set of the steps that defined these intermediate variables. Okay? So this pertains to the first layer, this is first layer, this is second layer. Okay? Now let's started from delta y. So here we started from x. Here we started from delta y equals the gradient of the loss at point y. Okay? Which we got here. So we first went forward. We have y. We can evaluate the loss at point y. We call it delta y. Okay? We call it delta y. Now we can compute delta a, which is written there, which is this diagonal of phi prime z times the diagonal of delta y times 1 y prime transpose. Okay? This was delta a. This pertains to the last layer, right? The second layer. Now we computed this, now we are going to the first layer. So we computed delta y prime, basically according to what is written there, the diagonal matrix formed by phi prime z. Actually, you never materialize this diagonal matrix, you are just doing the scaling. This is algebraically a nice way to write it, but you're actually scaling row by row. Times A transpose times delta y. So now you can forget about delta y and do everything in terms of delta y prime. And in terms of delta y prime, you compute delta b as this, right? The diagonal matrix formed by phi prime z prime. The diagonal matrix formed by delta y prime times 1 extra. Okay? So look how we did it. We propagated from the input of the network to the output of the network, okay? And then back. So we did what is called a forward pass. This is a forward pass. And then we did a backward pass. And basically, we applied the chain rule by using this recurrent relation. So currently, we just have two layers, but let me now summarize it for any arbitrary number of layers. And this is called error backward propagation, or back propagation for short. Basically, we are taking the gradient of this loss, and we are propagating it backward from the last layer to the first layer. And this is how we compute gradients. Okay? Basically, we are just breaking the calculation according to the chain rule, according to the structure of the network, according to the layers that the network has. Okay? So let me summarize it in the general case. I will not rewrite the notation. Let's just remember. Can you see it well? Not too bad. Yeah, let me.
The razor around the.
Yeah.
No, no, no.
No.
So let me write it in the general case. So in the general case, we have the forward pass. We have the forward pass. We start with y0. I will use y0 equals to x, and for k equals 1, 2 until l. From the first layer to the last layer, I compute zk equals wk yk minus 1. Now I can add the bias term plus bk and yk equals phi k, the kth layer nonlinearity zk. And then we output, obviously we output y equals to yl. The output of the last layer is the output of the net. Okay? Now we do the backward pass. in the backward pass, we start with the gradient of the loss as dyl. Sorry, delta yl is the gradient of the loss at point yl. Or y, doesn't matter. Let's call it y. Okay? Then 4k going from L down to 1. Here we're going in the backward direction. We compute delta wk as then delta yk, then phi prime k zk, 1 yk minus 1 transpose. Now delta bk, we didn't do the derivation of the trivial, right? Basically, the bias is not multiplied by anything, so it doesn't have any inner limit. So it will be that, just have the outer derivative, this that delta yk, and the outer derivative is phi prime k as zk. Okay? And then delta yk minus 1, which is that phi k prime zk w k transpose delta yk. Okay? And this technique was basically known as backpropagation or backward propagation, was proposed depending on whom you would like to give credit to, but probably from the 70s or even the late 60s. Basically, it's just an elegant way to apply the chain rule to your network.
Alex?
Yes.
I have sort of a non-trivial question. This y vector that we're speaking about. So let's say its dimensions are m, right? That's what we assume. And when you take a gradient of this, so you actually expect that every entry is sort of a function. Because a gradient is a derivative, like entry by entry, if I see you.
Sure.
So the thing is that when I try to track steps, it seems like I'm ending with vector with a finite numbers inside in each entry. And
of course, it's the derivative with this, at that point with respect to every coordinate, every degree of freedom of the entry.
So what am I derivating? I mean,
the loss function with respect to each of these parameters, right? So this is just an intermediate step. We don't really need need this delta yk. We really need the delta w's and the delta b's. Because the delta w will be a block of coordinates in that long gradient with respect to theta, right?
Mm.
So basically, you're doing gradient steps by taking the negative sign of this delta w and delta b and multiplying them by some step size.
Oh,
right?
So they actually contain the sort of this function that I can derive.
This is your direction, right? This is at least some block of coordinates of your direction.
Yeah, I believe this is my
or with a negative sign.
And we have some epsilon quantity that we said is eta, right?
Well, this epsilon, yes.
Right.
Doesn't necessarily need to be very small. Usually, it is decaying.
Arbitrary and decaying.
Well, it's not arbitrary. Basically, the optimization is very sensitive to the step size, but it should decay. Okay? Now, one thing that you might notice here, now, suppose you have a network that has 20 layers, and if you want to calculate the gradient of the parameters of the first layer, basically the gradient of the loss function, the output, with respect to the parameters of the first layer, you are going to need to calculate the product of phi prime L minus 1, phi prime L minus 2, until phi prime 1, right? Suppose now your nonlinearity is such that this derivative is approximately 2. So with 20 layers, you are going to blow up your gradient by a factor of 10 to the power of 6. And if it is 0.5, you will attenuate it by the factor of 10 to the power of minus 6, right? Mm-hmm. And this phenomenon is called vanishing or exploding gradients. Basically, numerically, it is practically impossible to do any optimization with with even modestly deep network, 20 layers is not so deep nowadays, just because of this numerical problem. So we have a gradient, but it's practically zero, or it's very big. So it's extremely unstable. And until recently, maybe less than 10 years ago, people could not use backpropagation. So they use those sigmoid functions that I showed you. Basically, they are very susceptible to vanishing and exploding gradients. And what people did, they did some kind of unsupervised training of all the layers. We'll see in how exactly. And then did backpropagation just to fine-tune each layer at a time individually, which was really something that prevented really efficient training on big amounts of data until basically the rectified linear unit was proposed, which basically has an interesting property that it has the unit is either exactly zero or exactly one. So if you multiply them, you get either zero or exactly one. So there is no vanishing or exploding gradients. You still get many zeros because it is sufficient to have one. So if you go in the path from the output to the input, it's sufficient to have one of the outputs, one of the activations in the negative part of the domain, then you have zero in the gradient. But basically what it appears that this actually helps optimization. Actually, this is a nice regularization. It promotes sparse solutions. And you still have many, many paths that give you the derivative of one, but it is never something that is going to explode or to vanish. Okay? So basically this relative function was actually, so if you can pinpoint to, I would say, few major algorithmic changes from the classical neural networks from the 70s or the 80s to what is now rebranded as deep learning, ReLU is one of them, but ReLU really allowed to do backpropagation training end-to-end with more or less arbitrary initialization. Okay? So it was a really a minor change, but a very significant impact on the usability of these models. Okay? Any questions? Well, basically, we are going to use backpropagation all the time. So, fortunately, you don't need to code it yourself. TensorFlow or PyTorch will do it automatically for you. Basically, these packages use automatic differentiation. Okay, so let's move next. So now, and probably I would have to steal a little bit, I don't know, maybe 5 or 10 minutes from the next hour. I won't be here next week, and time will give the next week's lecture, but I would like to tell you a few words about convolutional networks and shift invariants. So basically, if you take this multi-layered perceptron with many, many layers and big matrices, you have a huge number of degrees of freedom. And a huge number of degrees of freedom means that, first of all, your hypothesis class can represent really many functions, but it also means that you are really in trouble because you can simply memorize your training set instead of doing generalization, so you can overfit. Right? And this is always a danger in using too rich models. So and of course we have many degrees of freedom, so numerically it is a challenge also, the network takes a lot of memory. So basically using fully connected layers is now something that is quite discouraged. Now what is the alternative? An alternative, you can think of it in terms of when you write a program and you have some repeating pattern of, repeating algorithmic pattern, you will probably wrap it as a function and just use function code to call it again and again. You can say more or less the same about the action of a neural network. It doesn't work for every type of data, but suppose your data is a signal or an image, right? And there is more or less quite a good reason to assume that if you are doing some operation, some local operation on an image, you are going to do the same operation in some other region of the image. So basically, you would like to do the same function call, so to say, at different locations of the input. So you would like to reuse or share the weights that you are going to apply at one place and basically reuse them in another place. Okay? Now, mathematically, this can be expressed by acquiring shift invariants. So let me write. I'm assuming now that my input is just infinite sequence of numbers, okay? Let's say scalar numbers, scalar inputs. Okay, so I will have my x, basically xi will be a sequence, I from z. And if I have an image, a two-dimensional sequence, then think of I as a multi-index from z to, okay, z squared. So basically just a fancier index. Now, my output, let's take the output yi, at point yi, y is also, of course, y is also an infinite sequence. So basically, the output at yi will be phi sum over j, what index they use? Sum over j, right? J ranging over z, w I j x j plus some b, let's call it b. Okay? So I just wrote explicitly the action of a single layer. Okay, this is a fully connected layer. A fully connected layer means that there is no particular structure to this matrix. Think of it as an infinite matrix with two infinite dimensions I and j. So basically, there is no particular structure to this matrix. Now, by saying that I would like to reuse the same weights, I would like the action of this, basically of this layer that I wrote here, to be shift invariant. Shift invariant means that I would like it to commute with the translation operation. Okay? So basically, it means that if I first shift x and apply and put it here, it is equivalent to basically to applying this operation and then shifting down by the same amount. Okay? So this means shifting invariant. Now, because of this, because basically this has to hold for every x, right? And phi is just an element wise nonlinearity. I can simply write that the sum over j, okay, let's look here at j, wi minus m, j xj plus bi minus m, m is the amount of shift, this has to hold for every x and every m, is equal to the sum over j, wi j x j minus m plus b. Okay? So this is the condition for shift invariance. Of course, obviously, you can immediately see that in order to satisfy this, we have to write equality between the coefficients, right? We need to write equality between the coefficients. So first of all, the b's, every bi will be a constant. It must be a constant, otherwise I don't get equality for every m and every input sequence x. Okay. Now let's write equality let me reindex this sum. I will write j prime, and j prime will be j minus m. Okay. So j prime is still an infinite sum. Wi j prime plus m, and x j prime plus b, okay? And now I need, so basically I have this xj multiplied by this coefficient, and I have xj multiplied by this coefficient. So in order to satisfy this relation for every x and every m, I would like for every m, wi minus mj to be equal to w I j plus m. And when I'm not writing j prime, I'm writing j. It's exactly the same, right? So basically, if you think of w as an infinite matrix, and this is rho I minus m, column j plus m, this means that the value of the element of the matrix here, and the value of the element here is equal, okay? And it is true for every m. So essentially, we have a structure that is formed by diagonals. So every diagonal will have the same numbers. Every, so basically, different diagonals will have different numbers, but all the elements on the diagonal will be the same. Essentially, it means that there are actually no two degrees of freedom in W. There are no two indices in W. We only depend on which diagonal we are, so we only depend on the difference between I and J, and not the specific values of I and J, right? And this is called the Toplitz structure for the German, actually Jewish theoretician Otto Toplitz. And basically, Toplitz structure is just another way of saying 15 variables. Okay? So if we now plug this knowledge into our expression here, what we will get is sum over j, w I minus j, xj plus b. I'm writing b because b now is independent of I. I will still find this from your next hour, I think. Okay, so this operation is called the convolution. So basically, multiplying by a Toplitz operator, you remember this was a matrix vector multiplication, right? Multiplying x by a Toplitz operator is called convolution. And it is denoted as w star x, and we are taking it at point I. And convolution is, by the way, a commutative operation, so we can also write this as phi sum over j w I x I minus j, which is, this is the convolution of x with w. Okay. So basically, once we impose these two invariants, we got a much simpler system, okay, which is described by convolution. And in the signal processing community, the action of linear fifth invariant systems is studied all the time. There are many reasons why, because they are easy to analyze, for example, using the Fourier transform. By the way, the Fourier transform diagonalizes Toplitz operators. So basically, all Toplitz operators, surprisingly or not so surprisingly, have the same eigenbasis, which is the Fourier basis. Okay, so that's why it's very nice, because instead of writing convolution, when you express your linear system in its eigenbasis, which is the same for all linear fifth invariant systems, you are actually getting a diagonal form, and then convolution becomes an element-wise product. Okay, so that's why the Fourier transform is such a frequent tool, for example, in signal processing. It's actually because of this diagonalization property. But basically, what we got here, we got a particular type of a linear, of this linear form of a fully connected layer, which is no more fully connected. Usually, the support of these weights will be very local, and you are just, think of it as a sliding window, which you are putting onto, like a mask with weights, you are putting it onto some point in the input, multiply, compute the sum, then you shift to another point of the input, again, multiply, compute the sum, and this is how the output is produced. This is the action of the convolution. So basically, just to complete the picture, how it is implemented in the convolutional neural network, basically, what is a convolutional layer in the neural network? What we are going to do, we are just going to take our inputs and apply to them a bank of convolutions, basically a bank of filters. So in the signal processing journal, convolution with some W is called filtering the signal X with W, and W is called the impulse response, because this is how the system will respond to a delta at the input. Okay, so since it's shifting invariant, the impulse response doesn't depend on the exact location of the delta. Right? It will be the same response shifted by the same amount. But for us, basically, assuming shift invariance was rather than principle, it was pragmatic, right? We just wanted to reuse the same weights. So basically, a convolutional layer, what we will have now, we will assume that we have basically a vector value sequence coming at the input, right? Remember, our inputs are vector value. So think, I use notation m. I have m sequences, x1 to xm, and each such x is an infinitely dimensional vector. It's a sequence, right? Of course, in practice, my image will have some finite support, So in the topless matrix, I would have some boundary effects. But for the sake of our discussion, basically, you can apply some Newton neural network on an instant stream of data. Okay? So these are my input sequences from xi to xm. And the outputs will be also sequences y1 to ym. Yn, sorry, might be a different number. And basically, in the terminology of convolutional neural networks, these are called channels or feature maps. Okay, we'll see when, specifically when we'll use these architectures for images, we will see why this name. Now, what we are going to do, we are going, like in a fully connected layer, we are going to basically apply a weight matrix, but now it will have a topless structure, and it will have basically a third dimension. There will be a sequence, there will be basically a bank of different filters, of convolutions with different weights. So basically, let me write yj. Yj is the jth sequence. So basically, I have my non-linearity. What I'm describing is just one layer, right? We have basically a few such layers stacked, one on top of the other. So we have I going from 1 to m. So it means that I'm summing over all the inputs. The inputs will undergo convolution with the filter wij, and it will be the convolution of the input number I. Okay, so basically I'm taking my input number I, I'm convolving it with the filter w11, I'm putting it through a nonlinearity, and I'm outputting it here, but basically for missing the sum. And of course there will be a bias to that as well. The BJ. So there is a bias B1 here. And I'm putting another filter here, adding it to this. Okay? Same story for the rest of the output. So it's exactly the structure of a fully connected layer, with the only difference that we have the topic structure for the weight matrix. Yes?
Every
yi has 7 dimensions for the elements? Yeah, of course you can reduce it to just one, but usually you have a certain number of input dimensions and a certain number of output dimensions. So pay attention that we have two indices here. So one index is basically the running index on your input or output sequence, which might be a multi-index if you have an image, for example, it will be a two-dimensional index. And then you have another dimension, basically the channel number. Like, think of three RGB channels in the input image, then you maybe create more channels for what is called feature map. It's a completely different feature. For every filter. Okay? Yes?
In convolutional networks, the filter is not defined. Also
as the dimension of the channels. For example, if you have
three RGB channels, so the filter also
will
have an extra dimension of three channels.
No, obviously. Basically, you see, basically, it's a filter back, right? So you're summing. So think of this.
So in an
image, that would be a two-dimensional matrix, but you have basically a few layers of such matrix, right?
Yeah.
So it's a cube, okay? And you're always summing over that last dimension.
Yeah,
right?
I missed the sum.
So there is a sum. There is this. Okay? Now, how do you do backpropagation? It's very easy. So remember, in backpropagation, you only needed to multiply by W when you do the forward pass, and multiply by W transpose when you do the backward pass. Okay? So multiplying by W is obviously doing convolution, right? What is multiplying by W transpose? So think of a topless matrix, right? So suppose you have W, the impulse response of this form. This is the impulse response. So in the topless matrix, it will be like this. The W zeros will be on the main diagonal. It's an infinite matrix. The W minus one will be here. The W one will be here. What happens if you transpose this? Well, you can think of it as correlation, but it's basically, it will be convolution with a mirrored filter. with a mirrored impulse response. So basically, multiplying by toplex matrix transpose is still a convolution, it's still a toplex matrix mirrored, basically in the time domain or in the space domain, depends on what is the dimension of your image, right? So basically, when you do the backward pass, all the places where you find the W transpose, you still perform convolution with the mirrored field. So it's really efficient. Okay? Well, we'll talk about it more in this hour and next week. Okay? But basically, convolutional neural networks is something that is extremely widely used in many applications, not only related to images, but also related to audio, to language.